Especially when it comes to graphs. You notice how you do something new and then all of a sudden graphs are back? You do something new and graphs are back again? Okay? You notice that before? Am I alone in this? Okay? Because what we're doing is we're looking at new kinds of expressions, then equations, then functions, then graphs. And then we come back to the next kind of expression, equation, function, graph. Okay? So the kinds of expressions we're going to look at are really linear. Okay? I guess we should include inequalities here. We look at linear, quadratic, cubic, and then general polynomials. And really, in truth, all of these are polynomials. So algebra is almost a study of polynomials. Okay? We want to know about those. What we want to work with their expressions. What's an expression? Harvey, what's an expression? An algebraic expression. About when you think of the word algebra, what do you think?
Math.
Okay, math. But there's like geometry, right? What do you think when you think of geometry?
Math.
Same thing.
Shapes.
Good. Geo, meaning a word for shape, and metry, meaning measurements. So the measurements of shapes. Algebra is a little different. What do you think of when you think of algebra? The geometry. X. Did you get these notes from some other class or something?
No.
Okay. X. Or not just X, A, B, C, D, whatever. Letters representing numbers is algebra. So what makes an algebraic expression?
Math.
Using what Dustin revealed to us about
2 plus X.
2 plus X. It's an algebraic expression. That example is a linear expression. Okay, because the power of x is 1. Okay? So any expression like that with x, x in parentheses, and multiplied by stuff, distributive property, dividing, adding, all that stuff, it's just an algebraic expression. What's the difference between an expression and an equation?
Oh, you have an equal sign in there.
That's it. Okay? An equation is one expression. Okay, we have an expression here, and on the other side, what do we have?
Another
expression. Then number 5 could be considered an expression. So x equals 5 is an equation. It's an algebraic equation. So we go from expressions where we're maybe you want to think in terms of like collecting like terms. You done that before?
Yes.
All right. So there's all this collecting like terms nonsense, right? About expressions. That's what all the expressions part is. We keep looping back through linear expressions, linear equations, linear functions, linear graphs, back through to quadratic expressions, quadratic equations, quadratic functions, quadratic graphs, and on and on and on. Okay. So when we get to equations, what are we trying to do with algebraic equations? What's our goal there?
Find what x represents.
Find what x represents. To solve. To solve for x. Or a or b or c, whatever. These expressions, practicing collecting like terms, about solving equations, okay? Solving linear equations, solving quadratic equations, solving cubic equations, solving polynomial equations. And we work our way to functions. Alright? Now, this you may not remember exactly the definition of a function. Do you know what a function is?
Michael's name.
That's an example of a function, is like a form of a function. The end of last class, or two classes ago, I pulled out the calculator and showed you.
Oh,
it was the last class.
It was last class, so it was one constantly talking. So we were talking about the going one.
Right, putting it in, doing all the steps, two, doing all the steps, three, getting all the steps, all the way to 999, doing all the steps and finding, what did you find by doing that?
They all worked.
No matter which one you used, you end up just having, you know, 999 and then your age. You figured out that happened. Now, when you pulled out the calculator, right, it's probably still there. Is that it? Take a number, double it, add 5, multiply that by 50, add 1765, and you had your birthday, which we'll assume this person has, subtract 1999. I think it was Cameron we used it as an example, is that right?
1997.
Who was born in 99?
Me.
You.
And you?
You?
Who, me?
You.
Both
of you.
Me.
Yeah. Okay. So this is for, well, Noah, because this was Noah's deal. He took all the time to do it, so he reaps the rewards. This is, well, it's an equation, right? But it's a function type of an equation because of this guy right here. Okay? With just an equation, all of this stuff would be equal to something, a number, or another expression with x in it, so that x could be determined. Okay? See what I'm saying there? So that x could be determined. But when we set it equal to y, what is y's job?
Other number.
To what?
Different number.
For y to be a different number? Yeah, to be a different number. We can think of y as being like a result of what?
X.
Of x and all the things that happen to x, right? When we cleaned this up for 1765 and 1999, we found out that it was the same as 100x plus, what's that come out to be?
How old are you?
16. Okay. 100x plus 16. So all of that stuff is just the same as 100x plus 16. Okay? Not really that spectacular. When I plug a number in for x, I just get 100 times that number plus 16, so I get x 100. And 16. Right. So, seeing that, we should see like whatever number I plug in, it should just be that number, and then 16 in two digits after that. And if we look at the table, we see exactly that. Whenever I plug in for x, except for decimals, I see that happening. I can plug in 1, it's 1, I can plug in 9, I can plug in 25, 324, right? All of the outputs for y1 and y2, both of those, we had two different functions on that screen. We get the same outputs because if you clean up the first one, we get the second, 100x plus 16. So that's a function. Function is to just put a number in and I see what comes out. Okay? That's the basics of what a function is. So when we think about algebra and functions, we just see input. Right, going into a function and getting some output from that function. Right? We can represent that function as an equation, as a table, right, xy table. We can see it as just a bunch of parentheses with numbers in them. Okay. If we're told what the input is and what the output is, we're looking at a function. One very particular representation of a function that we focus on a lot is a graph. Because all of these, like these numbers here that I get and these numbers here, right? If I put those numbers as pairs and represent them as a point on the graph, and I do that a lot over and over and over, I get the graph, the picture. Okay? So I wanted to give you this overview because it's not that big a deal. We do pretty much the same thing over and over and over. We look at expressions of different kinds. When we look at that expression, now we throw it into an equation and we figure out how can we solve for x in these equations. Okay? Like for linear equations, to solve for x, there's a lot of adding and subtracting to both sides of the equation and multiplying and dividing on both sides of the equation. Right? If any linear equation can be represented as basically, if you boil it all down, like x plus b equals something. All the numbers can be collected, all the x's can be collected, and if you have it equal to, for example, if you have 7 equals 5x plus 2, right? We can solve that equation. There's a lot of adding and subtracting on both sides, multiplying and dividing on both sides to figure out what x is. When we get to quadratic, it'll be a different deal. Solving quadratics, it's a different kind of a strategy. This doesn't work as well. But in essence, we will try to turn quadratic equations into two linear equations and solve both of those equations. So there's a lot of taking what we're looking at now, this new thing, turning it into the old thing. When we get a cubic, I'm trying to turn a cubic into a quadratic and a linear equation and solve both of those. I'm getting the feeling that you guys, you're just here to be in class, to finish that class, and done with that class. Is that fair? Okay. So I'm going to try and help you with that. But remember that this is what algebra looks like when you put it down to its most basic pieces. So we're going to start with linear expressions. Okay? In these ones, we're probably going to go through a little bit faster because you guys have had this stuff before. But by looking at your tests, I see it's a little rusty, especially when it comes to graphs. Okay? You ready for that? We're going to look at some expressions.
Yeah. When do we get our tests back?
I just used your tests to look at and see where we need to start. And it gave me an idea. I can give them back to you if you want. But they're not graded. They're not, like, I could if you want me to, if you're interested.
I just want to see what I got wrong.
Okay, well, I will do that. I will get through those and get them back to you, okay? All right. Okay, so let's start with some expressions, all right? I want you to kind of understand those expressions. The easy way to represent those expressions is what we've been doing, okay? So I'm going to give you a little number trick, basically those steps. You're going to recreate those steps with an algebraic expression and simplify that algebraic expression, okay? All right. It won't be like really a number trick. It'll just be, I'm just going to simplify it. It may not say, oh, you always get A or you always get X or your number plus another number, your age or whatever. So take out your notes and there to represent what I'm about to put up here as algebraic expressions. And once you have it represented as an algebraic expression, simplify that algebraic expression. Right, so I was just going to pick a number. Okay. How are we going to represent a number in algebra?
X.
A, B, C, whatever you like. Whichever letter is your favorite. I wouldn't recommend an O. Doesn't matter. Looks like a zero. Let's see. Let's multiply that by 3. Let's subtract 7. Let's multiply that by 5. Write an algebraic expression that does all of this same stuff in the right order. Okay. Set here. Okay. So take a number x, multiply by 3, how do I represent a number times 3? Don't leave me hanging, that's not shit take all day.
What?
So
4.
17.
5. 4.
Is this supposed to be a funny thing? How do we multiply by 3 is what I'm saying?
Oh.
How do we multiply by 3?
3x.
3x, okay. We're moving along. Now we subtract 7. Okay, multiply by 5. How do I show that I have all the result of this and multiply by 5?
Put it in parentheses.
Put this in parentheses.
And the f.
And then throw a 5 on there. I put 5 on the other side, on the left side instead of the right side.
Easily.
Difference?
No.
5 times 3, 3 times 5, is there a difference? No. It's called commutativity. The commutativity of multiplication. All right, so we multiply by 5, then what?
Add 3.
Add 3.
And add your number again.
Add your number again, your number is x. Point here is we're just going to clean it up until it looks pretty much like mx plus b. Any linear expression can have that done to it. So you see it there. Parentheses there, maybe that you didn't have. Okay. Simplify that expression until you just have a number times x plus a number or minus a number, depending on how that falls out. Okay. Go ahead. All right. So here we have parentheses times 5. How do I do this parentheses times 5? Because can I do 3x minus 7?
No.
Can that be combined?
No.
Good. Why not?
Because 7 doesn't have an x.
7 doesn't have an x? What's another reason?
You're multiplying, you're subtracting x by a number.
Yeah. And why doesn't that make sense? Why doesn't that, why isn't that possible?
Because there's no x. You can't combine the number.
Goodbye. It's got to be like terms. Yeah. You throw that away on all the time, like terms, like terms, like terms. It's true by the definition of what like terms are. Those aren't like terms. Like terms would be x's, or the same as x's, and x squared, so the same as x squared. Okay, good. It's, you know, a step ahead of someone who takes 3x and subtracts 7 and calls it negative 4x. Okay? It happens. I'm glad it's not happening to us today. So how do we do this? If I can't do the parentheses first, how do I multiply by 5?
Just do 5 times 3. And
5 times 3.
And 5 times 7.
And 5 times 7. Okay, so we have, what's it called?
Distributive property.
Distributive property. Distributed. Okay, there's the plus 3. It's just hanging out there waiting for these guys to be done with whatever they're doing. And then we add x onto there. Now what?
Combine like terms.
Terms. So combined like terms is really something we said when we think about, like, all this stuff has to follow the order of operations as well, right? And all this multiplication is going to happen first. As soon as x shows up, we're going to multiply them together, right? Now that we're down to the point where, well, we can't really multiply these together, what we can do is add and subtract. Add things and subtract things. So we could add the negative 35 and the positive 3, right? Get negative 2, I heard it whispered. Okay. Put 15x with the 1x. Right? What do we get? 16x. 16x minus 32. There it is. It's looking like mx plus b now. It's just 16x plus negative 32. So any linear expression can be cleaned up to look just like that. And this is, like I said, again, a linear expression. Do you remember why I called it a linear expression?
X plus or minus x, kind of.
It looks like mx really plus saying, b is definitely a way to say it's linear.
I'm saying that, but.
The how I can tell that it can wind up looking like this is because I see only x's, and I can tell that when I multiply everything together, I'm not going to wind up with anything like x squared or x cubed or x to the fourth or anything like that. It's all x to the what? What power does x have here?
15.
No, this is the
second
coefficient
power.
Of x. The coefficient is 16. What's that?
X to the second power.
This is x to the second?
Two x's combined.
Oh.
Yeah, never mind. I just realized.
No, but I see what you're saying. I'm looking at it right here. This x right here at the very bottom, last line here.
16.
X to the. What's that?
First power.
It's to the first power. Every number that you're looking at, it's just a number, right? That doesn't have an exponent written there. You can just think of it as to the first power. Same goes for x. If x doesn't have a power, it must be power of one.
You
just don't write things like, I could also, this is also multiplied by 1. I don't write that. It's also divided by 1. I don't write that. It's also having 0 add to it. I'll show you that, right? A lot of things are kind of there, but we don't write them down. Okay? So, first power, that's what x is. And as long as x is to the first power and there's no other ones, we're talking about the linear expression. Okay. Let's see. To take a number, multiply by 2, add 4, multiply by 2, add 2, divide that by 2, and add your number. Write a linear expression and simplify that linear expression. Making sure that the order happens in the way that we want it to, in this order, first to last. Okay. So first we pick a number, we represent the number with what?
X.
X. Okay. And then we multiply that number by 2. How do I show multiply a number by 2?
2x.
2x. Okay, and then I add 4. I won't patronize if I ask you how to add 4. Multiply by 2. But see, multiply by 2 is supposed to multiply the result of all of this, right?
Yes.
Supposed to multiply all of that by 2. If I just put times 2, what's going to happen by the order of operations?
You're going to have to do 4 times 2 first.
Yeah, that's it, 4 times 2, right? That doesn't include this step in that part of being multiplied by 2. So, to fix that,
you have parentheses.
All right, so far so good. It looks like we will multiply number by 2 first, then we will add 4, yes, then we'll multiply the result by 2. Looking good. Okay, so check. Add 2 to that. That should be fine, right? All that stuff will happen. Times 2, add 2, good. Check. Divide by 2. And just throw divide by 2 there. The order of operations, what's going to be?
Put parentheses.
Okay, and put parentheses around all of that, all the stuff from before dividing by 2 to make sure that dividing by 2 up to this point is the last thing that happens. Okay, so far we'll multiply number by 2, add 4, multiply the result of that by 2, add 2 to that. Then after all that's done, all the inside of this parentheses has been evaluated, then we'll divide by 2. Okay, so far we're good. And then we add our number. We'll add what? X. Okay. No parentheses needed. I don't have to put parentheses around all this stuff, right? Because order of operations tells me I'm not going to add 2 and x, right? I'm going to divide 2 into all of this. All right, so we go about cleaning this up. We go about simplifying this algebraic expression. How does that happen?
Distributive property.
Distributive property here. Okay, so we get 4x plus 8 plus 2 inside all these parentheses, divide by 2 plus x. All right, next. 5x?
4 plus 10.
4x plus 10. Okay. Not 14x. 4x plus 10. Multiplying a number by 4 and adding the number 10 to it is not the same as taking that original number and multiplying by 14. So 4x plus 10 is not 14x.
You need to divide both those numbers by 2.
Alright. Division distributes. If I'm dividing parentheses by something, division distributes just like multiplication. If you're not sure about that, like I'm not sure the division distributes, I can multiply this by 1/2. Dividing by 2 and multiplying by 1/2 is the same thing. And we know that the multiplication distributes. So we distribute this to 4x, we get 2x, distributed to the 10, we get 5, and we add x.
Which makes it 3x plus 5.
2x plus x is 3x plus 5.
Which is
2x plus x.
Yes.
Oh, that's good.
Okay. So we have three things. 1, 2, 3 things. And they're being added, and there's this thing called the commutativity, and this other thing called associativity. So we can move these guys around. I can move this x over next to this 2x, and we can add them together. 4 be out of 5, like, doesn't make a difference. Alright? Seems like we need a little more practice with this stuff, so let's do it again. Number. Multiply by 3 and subtract 2 and multiply by 6. Add 12. Divide. Subtract 7 and add twice your number. I mean, like, a number that's twice as big as your number that you started with. So, just real quickly, since we've all done it individually. Take a number, multiply by 3, subtract 2, multiply the whole thing by 6, add 12, divide the whole thing by 3. You might have put divide by 3 with parentheses. That should do the same thing, right? This is a, like, parentheses by putting the line under the whole thing. Divide by 3, subtract 7, and add twice your number, a number that is twice as big as the number that you picked. So we're kind of stuck. There's nothing really to combine. Right, I can't add the 3x and the negative 2, so I'm going to have to distribute the 6. And we get 18x minus 12 plus 12 divided by 3 minus 7 plus 2x. And negative 12 plus 12 is nothing. And we get 6x right there plus 2x is 8x minus 7. Alright, let's try it again. Let's take a number and multiply by 3 and subtract. Three times.